Hey, on Rhode Island Free Radio.
We'll be right back.
right. That was the unmistakable late David Bowie doing Suffragette City. Before that was Altar of Sacrifice, Slayer. And you'll notice that we're keeping to the themes tonight. You know, we followed the discussion of the terrorists with Altar of Sacrifice. And just to be fair, we followed the discussion of bisexuality with Suffragette City. So just never let it be said that we don't know how to follow through on a theme here on the Haunted Cabaret. Another thing that we were talking about, and this was on Chuckles' show, and we're going to talk about it again and some more because I never get enough of the subject, really. And I think a lot of our listeners don't either, so I don't feel too guilty about it, is if you like horror, if you like sex, if you like violence, chances are you like pro wrestling. I mean, would that be
all
a fair statement?
All of those are kind of
they're
combined.
All intertwined. They really are.
Yeah.
And while, you know, we were listening to Suffragette City, we were talking about off mic and, again, on Chuckles' show, but off mic afterwards, the wrestlers who can really carry a company on their shoulders, the ones that can't. And I guess, you know, the association, the mental association of ideas. While we were listening to Suffragette City, I started to think about pro wrestlers whose personas are, let's just say, a little, you know, in question between the male and the female.
Mm-hmm.
And I know in the history of pro wrestling, some of those characters, you know, that are a little bit, you know, gender non-specific, have been some of our best performers in wrestling.
Because everyone can relate to them. They're more...
Well, everybody can relate to them. Well, I don't know if everybody can relate
to
them.
Well, not necessarily in that way, but I mean...
I don't know if too many of the blue-collar wrestling fans down in Pittsburgh could relate to Goldust that well on a personal basis.
But they can span to a wider range of people.
Well, either you're going to dislike...
Because they can be entertained by them, or...
They're going to provoke a response one way or the other. Either a fan is going to dislike them, a fan is going to agree with them, a fan is going to be fascinated with them.
Yeah.
So they cover a lot of ground.
Yeah. They're more thought-provoking.
Yeah. And that's why I think a lot of these gender-neutral wrestlers, they're also tweeners, too. Would you say, Tony?
One of my favorites, a guy who I bought all of my wrestling gear off of, who is still in the business to this day in his 70s, Exotic Adrian Street. One of the original gender benders, who's straight as an arrow, married to his valet. But he really invented that character and was able to take it, because there were some characters along those lines in the 50s, but you really couldn't go all out back then.
Right. Well, I've seen some video of Gorgeous George. Now, he took it a little further than you would think that somebody would be able to take it in the 50s and 60s. And I think Adrian Street actually is modeled. Well, I think every gender bender persona in wrestling sense owes a little bit to Gorgeous George from back then. But yeah, Adrian Street was a definite direct influence. And Adrian Street, he got some notoriety, right? But he never rose to the level.
Yeah, he was never a main eventer, that's for sure.
No. And it brings to mind, there's a couple of other wrestlers that I thought, me personally, whether it was back in the day of, I guess you would say, well, it was WWE Attitude Era, but even before that, in the Hulk Hogan superhero era, and then even more recently, a couple, the ones that come to mind that I think could have carried a company on their shoulders and were never given the opportunity, one was a wrestler named Chris Candido.
Yeah.
And he came to the WWF at that time. He was a member of the Body Donnas, you know, with Sonny.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you, he was a guy, and then they put him in a tag team where he didn't, you know, his tag team partner wasn't worthy of being on the team with him. I think that was part of the problem. But no, if it had just been Chris Candido with Sonny as his manager, I think Chris Candido could have been a WWF champion. He could have carried the company for a while. He never got the opportunity. Now, granted, they gave him some belts in some of the lesser organizations, but he could have gone a lot further. The other one is, more recently, is Orlando Jordan. If that rings a bell.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you know, now, if I'm not mistaken, they tried him out in WWE for a while. Now, did he go back to TNA, or did he start out and did he get his first break in TNA and then went to WWE?
I would hazard to say, Maniac Mike would know this a lot better than me, but...
Well, I'm not, it's not important anyway, because...
I don't remember him too much.
No, it doesn't matter anyway, because the point is that in both organizations, he was given a little bit of a push and then dropped back down to mid-card, dropped back down to scrub, and let go. Now, and like I said, he's another one, you know, I watched him in TNA, and I said, this guy, if they do things right, this is a big star. This is a guy that could be up there with some of the legendary characters in wrestling. They didn't do it. But I don't know. I think a lot of times when in wrestling, it's bad decisions by the promoters. I mean, other than in politics, I don't know of any other organization or any other profession where there's such nepotism and, what would you say, Chuck, personality. In other words, they don't make the right decisions because of personal opinion.
They make the right decisions on what they call clicks.
Right.
Clicks in professional wrestling. It's there.
Yeah, it have, and you know, there's clicks in business, there's, you know, in corporate business, there's clicks in other sports. There's clicks everywhere, but would you say in wrestling it's really bad and it gets in the way sometimes of making the right decisions?
Oh, it is more really than other bad. Places? Attitude Era. You ever want to watch a really good interview, watch Bret Hart, and he'll talk your ear off about the click and how bad it was. And that's one of the decisions that made him say, I'm out of here, because if you weren't in that area, you weren't going to get the proper boost that you needed.
Right, because the click at that time was?
Shawn Michaels, Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, Triple H.
See, and at least they were honest enough to call it the click. Mm-hmm. Right? That, I mean, didn't they really call... I know Shawn Michaels called one of his groups the Click.
Yeah, it was the Click, but it stayed under wraps as the Click. Remember, that's what Triple H got in trouble for, hugging them?
He was one of the first times a wrestler came out of character in the WWF. And, right, Vince put him in the doghouse for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, he could have stayed there. I'm not a fan of Triple H. I mean, I understand he's devoted to wrestling, but... Now I wonder how much, you know, because that's always been, Triple H lives and breathes and bleeds wrestling. But I wonder how much these days, because he always seems to put himself first. You know, he's not one of these guys, as opposed to, let's say, Mick Foley, who, you know, when he saw that his knees were shot to hell, he took it upon himself to do the very best he could to put over the young guys and, you know, give them... You know, needed exposure, give them everything they needed, to like Randy Orton, among others. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, one of the reasons that Randy Orton finally got over, even though he was misused as a character later on, Randy Orton got put over big time by Mick Foley when they had that. Well, it was one of many for Mick Foley, but it was Randy Orton's first hardcore match. Remember when he went into the tax and he took the Mick Foley elbow from the steps? That's when they. Randy Orton proved that he was a tough guy.
Randy Orton back in the day got his ass handed to him by every wrestler when he first came in.
They did. It was almost like, well, I guess he came from a wrestling pedigree.
Right.
His dad, Cowboy Bob Orton, and then even his grandfather. So, yeah, they weren't going to make it easy. The other wrestlers weren't going to make it easy for him.
Oh, no, he took his dues. Yeah. I mean, he definitely did. I remember some of the matches with Kane, and Kane's an easy worker, but it looked like he was going a little extra stiff on this young kid to get him out. Taker, yeah, same thing. Some of the other legends he went in the ring with, they seem to have taken great joy in giving him a couple extra freaking...
And dismantling this poor kid.
Yeah, he's either going to make it or...